Thank you. The next item of business is a member's business debate on motion 7327 in the name of Liam Kerr on Scotland's courts maintenance backlog. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to seek to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Liam Kerr to open the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Mr Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm very grateful to those members who signed my motion and have remained behind to both listen and contribute today. I remind the Chamber, of course, that I am a practising solicitor and I am a member of the Law Society of Scotland, although I have not done criminal and or legal aid work since 2004. Now, it will come as no surprise to anyone that I drafted and lodged my motion with an eye on my North East region and the future of our local courts. And that situation is a function of where Scotland's justice system finds itself presently. You see, according to the Scottish Courts and Tribunals Service, there are currently more than 28,000 trials backlogged in Scotland's courts. Now, that is a reduction from the over 30,000 when I lodged the motion, but that's still an increase of nearly 10,000 on 2019-20. And in our sheriff courts, the problems are the worst, with the backlog nearly five times the pre-pandemic average. Now, I mention the pandemic because I've no doubt that in responding, the Minister will blame as much as possible on it. And of course, we all recognise that COVID caused huge disruption. And on that note, it's important to commend all those involved in the system who adapted so quickly and worked so hard to keep things moving. But the government cannot deny that major backlogs existed prior to March 2020. And that's on their watch. And those delays have a real human cost. Victim Support Scotland said court delays damage victims' mental health and can further traumatise them. It also risks under or even non-reporting due to the length of time the justice process can take. It sees witnesses being forced to take long bus trips alongside defendants and potentially dangerous people being left to roam Scotland's streets. I will.
Jamie Green.
Can I thank my colleague for taking an intervention? We heard some pretty horrific evidence as part of the Justice Committee that some victims of crime are actually dropping proceedings altogether and removing themselves from the process due to the lengthy delays, due to the re-traumatisation in those delays. Would that not be a huge cause of concern, particularly for his own constituents in the North East?
Liam Kerr.
Very grateful. Of course it is a huge cause of concern, and anecdotally I've heard similar things occurring in the North East and indeed further around Scotland. And it's not even surprising, given that when cases are finally called, one can quite often see victims being crammed in, often cramped and crumbling under-resourced courts, cheek by jowl, with witnesses and even the accused. So if we assume that the pre-pandemic level of backlog represents the, quote, reasonable baseline level that Eric McQueen of the SETS told the Criminal Justice Committee he thought could be returned to by 2026, our courts are really going to have to go some to get there. To achieve that baseline, Mr McQueen told the committee the court system would require to max out available capacity. So nationally, we are really going to have to make all our assets work at or actually over capacity if we are to achieve what Mr McQueen says we can. Yet, one of our new First Minister's previous roles was Justice Secretary, and true to form, whenever he's held a post, he presided over a decrease in capital funding for the court service of more than £10 million. Now, to put that in context, in 2018-19, SCTS received £22.9 million in capital funding to repair courts and upgrade buildings. In 2023-24, they will get £12.7 million. That is a massive reduction in funding in a situation in which, as at July 2022, there was a maintenance backlog on the court's estate of around £7.3 million, which is why, when SCTS said in October 22 that closing 3 to 4 court buildings could save £4 million, the people of Scotland started to worry, particularly in the North East. Because, Presiding Officer, 10 years ago, The SNP government looked to make court savings that would save the Scottish Court Service about £1.3 million annually and £3 million as a one-off. So they closed 10 sheriff courts. And the North East lost their sheriff courts in Arbroath and Stonehaven. Or rather, they closed, because it then took the best part of 5 years to get them off the books, during which time SCTS had to pay for vandalism, alarms and general repairs anyway, before selling them on community asset transfers, which yielded pennies, leading local solicitors to be sceptical that any money had actually been saved at all. And to what end? Well, court business was transferred out of Angus and the Mearns, including sheriff and jury trials. Indictments went to Dundee or Aberdeen, and that led to victims of crime facing long journeys by car or public transport, if it was available, which is by no means guaranteed, only to find that there's yet another delay because of the very backlogs we looked at earlier, which we've seen have rocketed from an already eye-watering start. And arguably, this ripped the heart out of communities in Arbroath and Stonehaven overnight. And that is what is worrying folk in the North East. A history of closures, a massive repair bill to fix courts which already look like they're being run down, £7.3 million of repairs this year, including £280,000 at Peterhead, and a government which has slashed the funding. People outside the SNP's Central Belt heartland know where this ends up. And that's why I asked the Cabinet Secretary a fortnight ago to provide us with the certainty that in the North East there will be no more court closures in the lifetime of this Parliament. And after saying simply that there are no plans, he went on a bizarre rant about the UK government and courts in England. So I'll conclude by simply saying this. The justice budget is within the gift of the Scottish Government to decide as a spending priority. There is a far smaller court footprint in Scotland than in other parts of the UK, especially after the purge started by the SNP in 2013. The court estate is crumbling under this government, so much so that repairs across Scotland almost swallowed up the entire capital budget in 2022. So for the certainty of victims, the people of the North East and Scotland, the morale and jobs of our court workers, I ask the Minister in closing to reverse the SNP's putting criminals first and support our courts by stating here and now there will be no court closures in Scotland in the lifetime of this Parliament. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. We now move to the open debate. I call Audrey Nicol to be followed by Jamie Green. Around 4 minutes, please, Ms. Nicol.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to start by thanking Liam Kerr for bringing this debate forward on court maintenance backlogs. And for the record, whilst I am convener of the Criminal Justice Committee, I'm not speaking in that capacity this afternoon, although I will refer to some aspects of the committee's work. I'd also like to go back to the COVID-19 pandemic, when many public services were reduced or halted. However, our courts staff and staff in the wider criminal justice system continued delivering functioning courts and other services under the most challenging circumstances. And as a North East constituency MSP, I know that this commitment was evident in courts in Grampian and the wider Highlands and Islands. And of course, the pandemic did create an opportunity to introduce new ways of working using technology to support remote jury centres and virtual trials, introduced at short notice and for the most part working well. The introduction of technology and other adaptations was set against the backdrop of a court's estate that comprises a broad range of assets, from the comparatively new Glasgow Sheriff Court to the Court of Session here in Edinburgh. And Scotland has a long tradition whereby justice is often delivered in buildings of historical significance that reflect perhaps the solemnity of the proceedings taking place within them and are considered part and parcel of our criminal justice system. But there is no escaping this comes at significant cost in terms of adaptations that are required, maintenance, heating, repairs and so on, which I know is the focus of the member's motion today. And as we know, the prioritisation of court buildings maintenance is an operational matter for the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service, with, not unusually, capital works undertaken on a priority basis. And of course, it is also the case that what is spent south of the border on justice has a direct consequence for what is available here in Scotland. Now, I note Liam Kerr's motion refers to the disruption caused to court business due to maintenance work. Specifically, it references repairs to Scotland's courts are often require closures, which can add to the already large number of outstanding criminal trials. Now, I recognise the point the member is making. However, I would be interested to know more detail about this claim, as it's not one I'm particularly aware of. Neither do I recall it being raised previously with either local SCTS colleagues in the North East or indeed in the Criminal Justice Committee. Rather, maintenance is inevitable in the function of any public buildings, and given the proficiency with which court staff already manage court business, I am pretty confident disruption to court business is and has to be kept to an absolute minimum. So, returning to the backlog of cases, I very much welcome the efforts that are being made to tackle this, but as the member said, there is much, much more to do. The Criminal Justice Committee's last budget report highlights the Scottish Government must find extra resources in its budget to provide a better settlement for organisations in the criminal justice sector than that proposed in the May 2022 resource spending review. And in his evidence to committee, the Chief Executive of the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service highlighted the progress made over the past 2 to 3 years to tackle the backlog of cases, but also highlighted the impact on this progress should additional budget not be forthcoming. So I'm pleased that despite the difficult financial climate for public spending, the Cabinet Secretary for Justice was able to find additional much needed funding for the system. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I welcome this debate this afternoon highlighting the issue of maintenance backlogs in our courts, and I thank Liam Kerr for bringing it forward.
Thank you, Ms Nicol. I now call Jamie Green to be followed by Pauline McNeill. Around 4 minutes, please, Mr Green.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I thank my colleague Liam Kerr for bringing this important debate to the Chamber today. Whilst he's highlighting errors from his own region, he does paint a picture of what is happening right across the country. And can I also express some sympathy for the Justice Minister who's been sent to the front bench today, because it's not her fault that the many of her predecessors, Justice Secretaries, of which I think we're on our fifth now in the last 10 years, are here to defend their decisions that have led to the backlog that we see today, both the court case backlog that was there long before COVID, as my colleague pointed out, but also that maintenance backlog, which I want to talk about. The Scottish Courts and Tribunal Services are such a key cog in the complex wheel of Scotland's justice system. It is not just the people and the buildings, it's the expertise, the systems, including the IT systems, that all have to work to ensure that justice is served, because justice has to be served for not just the accused, but also the complainant as well. And it must be as transparent as possible to ensure that we have continued public faith in it. That's not easy, but ultimately courts have the ability and power to deprive people of their freedom, and that removal of that liberty, sometimes for quite a prolonged period of time, makes it one of the most important buildings in public estate. So it's crucial that we raise these issues. It's not just Forfar and Peterhead and all the other places that Liam Kerr spoke about. I've got the 2022-23 maintenance backlog here in front of me, and it's quite a sight, it's quite a shopping list. Every single sheriff court I can see is in order for repairs. We've got £200,000 in Greenock Sheriff Court, half of which is a boiler. We've got £385,000 for windows in Alloa. We've got £190,000 for electrics in Dunfermline and over £1 million in Glasgow on something called tanking, whatever that is. But it's dampness, it's water ingress, it's electrics, it's roofs, it's drainage. They're falling apart, and they've been falling apart for years. Of course, no one's disputing the fact that buildings which are old, sometimes more than a century old or more, fall apart. Of course things need repaired, but the problem is if you don't do it when it needs to be done, the backlog accumulates. And if you look at what's happening, and we've had debates in this chamber not long ago about our fire and rescue state and our police stations, if you let it accumulate, Minister, the problem is you end up with a massive big bill that no government on earth has the money to pay for. And that's not Westminster's fault, that's the fault of this government here, who should have been investing and listening to warnings from STCS. Every budget cycle that it went through when it gave submission to a number of justice committees, I don't have time for interventions, I'm afraid. I'd love to take them all. If I get a few minutes back, I'll happily do
Yes, certainly, Mr. Green.
Oh, great. Well, I'll start with
Grateful
this one.
Grateful to the member. Does he support greater borrowing powers for this Parliament to invest in capital infrastructure?
Jamie Green.
You don't need to borrow money, I say, to Ms Clark, who's defending the SNP benches here, clearly, this afternoon. You should stop wasting money on failed projects. This government is notorious for wasting money. You'll know that, colleagues. If they spent their money better, we wouldn't need to borrow more in the first place. The reality is here is that every time our public services ask for capital investment, they've been under-delivered. And the SETS is no different. They asked for £23 million. In 2018 and 19. This year, they've been given 12.7. It's a massive reduction. It's not even going to scratch the surface. You don't need to borrow to fix that problem. The problem is that how do we get to this place? And this is where I find the evidence is actually from SCTS themselves. They wrote to the Scottish Government. I have a letter here which is highly redacted. It was from an FOI, and I have to say the brave soul that had the guts to write to the government to St Andrew's House on this made it starkly clear what the problem was. As a result of their capital budget being severely stretched, I'm paraphrasing, we've had to divert money from essentially their estate's backlog maintenance to digital services. It was a sensible short-term solution, but it's not sustainable as it risks future building failure and additional costs and maintenance will simply escalate. They go on to say that we need to provide a safe and secure environment for all court users and continue to invest in critical services at pace and at scale. The problem is, Deputy Presiding Officer, is that chronic underfunding of the system has left these buildings on the verge of collapse. The problem I have with all of this is what experience do victims of crime have as they go through the court system? We know that it's already a traumatic experience, but it's made so much more worse when they're in buildings where they have to share communal spaces, toilets, cafeterias, waiting rooms, with both the families of the accused, with sometimes the accused themselves if they haven't been remanded into custody. And victims, time after time, I've got numerous quotes I could share with the Chamber from victims of crime who say how traumatic and degrading that whole experience is because of the nature of the environment that they're in. I would have loved to have given way, but I'm sure the Minister will have plenty of opportunity in her closing time. All I would do is make a plea here, is that we need our courts to be functioning well. They need to be fit for purpose, and they also need to have the ability not to re-traumatise victims of crime, because ultimately they're there to serve a vital purpose, and no amount of whataboutery will deter from the fact that they have been chronically underfunded. That must change whoever's in charge.
Thank you, Mr Green. And I now call Pauline McNeill, who will be the last speaker in the open debate. Around 4 minutes, please, Ms McNeill.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thanks to Liam Kerr for bringing this important subject to the Chamber as a choice for members' debate. Liam Kerr doesn't mean I'm going to focus almost exclusively on court delays, because it's something we have actually been on the Labour benches very critical of the current situation. I took an interest in court delays in 2018 following a constituency case, a horrendous case of a gang rape, which took 3.5 years to come to court, and there was an acquittal. So I do accept that COVID-19 has had significant disruption in the operation of the criminal justice system in Scotland and elsewhere, causing considerable strain to the system, leading to significant delays in the processing of cases. But it pre-existed COVID, I'm clear about that. But like Liam Kerr, would also put on record my sincere thanks to the Crown Office and the Scottish Court Tribunal Service, who have done an incredible job through COVID getting our courts running. But it causes uncertainty for those who are caught up in our system, criminal justice system, victims, witnesses and accused persons. It's not justice if they have to wait years to be heard. Long before lockdown and the disruption of the criminal justice process, challenges faced by victim survivors as a result of delays in their case progression, poor communication and uncertainty about trial dates and last-minute changes to court, I have to say, were long well established. How far back it goes would be an interesting point of research. But I do know that the remoteness that victims feel to the system by not having that kind of communication through long delays, it is why myself and Katie Clark have been supporting, or one of the reasons, that there should be advocacy for victims of sexual offences who are waiting for justice to be heard in court. There's a large number of outstanding criminal trials, what Liam Kerr already talked about, which currently stands at 30,588 trials across all criminal courts. And the latest figure shows that serious sexual offences constitute 70% of High Court work, which is really quite astonishing. 80 to 85% of cases that proceed to a trial affecting thousands of women and children at the receiving end of such violence. I mention that because I've got a specific interest in it, but those figures would necessitate a need for an interest in this in any case, because a crucial dimension of systematic violence against women and girls is the lack of access to justice and courts. And the Lord Advocate herself, Dorothy Bain, who served prior to being Lord Advocate, as a practitioner on heading up the serious sexual violence unit, has previously commented on the extraordinary number of sexual violence cases caught up in the backlog that she says predominantly and disproportionately affects women and children, something which the Justice Committee, along with the Scottish Government, will scrutinise later on this year. A year ago this month, as the Parliament discussed the backlog of cases, Cabinet Secretary then Justice Keith Brown told us that the government allocated £5.32 million to tackle the backlog, including measures to provide 16 additional courts, which we haven't seen any of, which is one of the points made by the member. But what that £53.2 million really amounts to is something we do really have to look into over time, because that money has to show that it's actually creating results to get this delay down. Now, I do accept that and in fact, we did actually have this debate during the COVID emergency legislation. We did not think we should have extended the time limits to 360 days up until 2026. So we're quite clear that, because we're concerned that if there's a deadline such as that, then it will be used. However, I suppose what we need to ascertain is whether or not, as we head towards 2026, that those delays will come down. Because at the moment, there's an average of 49 weeks delay in the High Court. Now that amounts to, I hope my figures are correct, I'll be corrected by the Minister if I'm wrong, but the 95 Act that this Parliament agreed to was the maximum number of days in the High Court for 140 days and 110. And we did that because in Scotland we believed that it was justice to have strict time limits. And the country that had the best time limits in the world, apart from two countries, is probably now looking pretty poor compared to other countries. And that 49 weeks amounts to 105 days over, on average, the current 95 Act, which is 140 days. So that isn't good for survivors, victims. It's not good for the accused people. And a point that was made by the Criminal Justice Committee is that those in remand waiting for their cases to be heard, and we've heard of cases of people being waiting up to 2 years or more for their cases to be heard, don't even know what priority is given to their case. I have pleaded with the Crown Office. There needs to be some transparency. Where these delays are what they are, to give accused persons in particular some idea when their cases will be heard. I conclude on this, Presiding Officer. I think it's something, an issue that we really need to continue to return to. It's a really important issue for our criminal justice system. We must see week on week progress to get that 49 weeks down to what the law should be, and that's no more than 140 days in High Court cases. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms McNeill. I now call on the Minister, Elena Whittam, to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I do apologise to everyone if I end up in a coughing fit. I have a very chesty cough at the moment. I am grateful for this debate, as it is an opportunity to advise Parliament about what I believe is an emerging positive report of recovery and transformation of our justice system. At the outset, let me be clear about some of the points that Mr. Kerr and others have raised. He has sought to characterise the backlog maintenance within the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service estate as an investment failure. He also raised the prospect of court closures. This is simply inaccurate on both points. There are no plans to initiate further court closures in Scotland. The Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service is of the view, and I agree with that view, that the current court model provides appropriate access to justice for Scotland's communities. However, there is always more work to be done. With regards to backlog maintenance, this is a professional industry standard approach which looks forward to assess future investment requirements to keep buildings safe and operational. In order to ensure the court estate remains in good condition, SCTS sets a minimum target of investing 1% of the value of the estate in backlog maintenance each year. This is approximately £5.3 million based on current evaluation. Through additional in-year funding provided by this government, SCTS has been able to invest above that 1% figure in recent years and to schedule work such as the replacement of the Glasgow Sheriff Court roof. And just to put that in a little bit of context, this year the total investment in terms of backlog maintenance investment is approximately going to be about £8 million, so again above that 1% figure. And over the last years, the backlog maintenance has come down significantly from £39 million to the current figure of £29.5 million. It's also important to provide some context to this figure. SCTS managed what is a vast and complex estate, as has been mentioned previously. Over half of the court buildings are listed, and a number of these are significant landmarks based on World Heritage sites. SCTS have assessed that the level of investment and maintenance is sufficient to maintain the estate in a safe and operational condition. And I have no reason to doubt that assessment. The SCTS record of successfully managing the court estate speaks for itself. SCTS has led a number of important innovations, including the establishment of the Inverness Justice Centre opened in 2020, and the vulnerable witness suites to avoid children and vulnerable witnesses having to physically attend court, and the use of cinemas as remote jury centres to allow the most serious of cases to continue during the COVID pandemic. And over the last decade, whilst facilities have sometimes been taken out of commission to allow planned improvement works to take place, there have been no instances where a maintenance issue has resulted in unscheduled court closure or impacted on any trials. But of course, the modern justice system is made up of more than its physical estate. Having digital capabilities which support modern person-centred services is a critical part of our transformation agenda. Building on innovation and new ways of working introduced as part of the justice response to the coronavirus pandemic, we are continuing to focus on deploying technology and new approaches to make the system more joined up, working better for everyone who experiences it. Recently, the Cabinet Justice Secretary visited Dundee to see in action the new digital evidence sharing capability, DESC for short, being piloted there. The DESC programme is a world-leading major programme of digital transformation which has seen the Scottish Government and its criminal justice partners come together to radically overhaul the way that evidence is shared in the criminal justice system in Scotland. DESC will make it easier to share evidence, allowing swifter access and helping cases to be resolved more quickly, reducing inconvenience and the risk of trauma to victims, witnesses and other users of the justice system. None of us here want to have victims being re-traumatised, and this is something that we need to move on. At £33 million, DESC represents a significant investment by the Scottish Government, but as well as being transformative in its own right, it creates the foundation for future transformation, both as a technology platform and in terms of its pathfinder role in establishing a successful model of collaborative delivery of system reform. We are also continuing to invest substantially in increased court capacity. This has contributed to the strong progress we have seen in clearing the backlog of summary criminal cases. Since January last year, the number of outstanding summary trials has reduced by over a third and is continuing to fall. That's more than 15,500 cases cleared from the backlog so far. But we do want to see similar progress in High Court and Sheriff and Jury cases. As Pauline McNeill outlined before, these are cases sometimes of some of the most traumatic for victims. So from April, the extra summary courts will be replaced by new additional solemn courts, creating more capacity to deal with the most serious of cases. This has been made possible because, despite the challenging financial context, our 2023-24 budget protects recovery funding of over £26 million for the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service. In addition to increasing court capacity, we have worked with our justice partners to address the impact of the backlog on vulnerable witnesses through facilitating the expansion of pre-recorded evidence. This includes investing...
Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful. I'm listening very carefully to all the measures that are being put forward, but it begs the simple question, when will all of these measures reduce the backlog to what we want it to be and start hitting the targets that Pauline McNeill quite rightly majored on?
Minister.
Yeah, I think that's something that whoever's in this post, whether that's myself and whoever is the Cabinet Secretary for Justice, and coming is something that's going to have to be kept a keen eye on and brought back to the Chamber to discuss, because that is something that we obviously want to see those numbers reducing dramatically. And we have already seen the summary cases have reduced by over a third, and I want to see those cases in solemn trials and high court trials reduced significantly as well. We are also investing £2 million in development of dedicated evidence by commissioner hearing suites and associated infrastructure to enable increased use of pre-recorded evidence. This funding has delivered three suites located in Glasgow, Edinburgh and Inverness, which collectively have capacity to deliver almost 1,500 hearings a year. And a fourth suite in Aberdeen is in development, and once open, this will enable an additional 480 hearings to take place each year. We've also reached a pivotal phase in our journey towards introducing the Bairnshaus in Scotland with the publication of National Bairnshaus Standards in May, which will then be tested in Pathfinder areas during our first phase of development. The Government is committed to delivering our vision for justice. In spite of a decade of austerity imposed by the UK Government, I am confident that with the current level of funding provided by this Government, and the additional borrowing powers that Katie Clark mentioned would be very welcome as well, the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service will continue to use their resources in the most focused and effective way to deliver justice services meeting the needs of our modern Scottish society. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I am minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 11.2.4 of Standing Orders that decision time be brought forward to now. I would invite the Minister for Parliamentary Business, George Adam, to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm moved.
Thank you, Minister. The question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. And in fact, there are no questions to be put as a result of today's business. So that concludes decision time, and I close this meeting.